Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. My name is Marcus Grodi, your host for this program. It's always a pleasure to be with you and to have this opportunity to introduce to you men and women who, because of their great love for Jesus Christ, are brought home to the Catholic Church, often a journey they never expected, or maybe one they began long ago and then went on a variety of journeys and then again, against their dreams, found themselves home in the Catholic Church. My guest tonight is Deacon Joseph Pasquella. Now, he's had an interesting journey, which you're going to hear in a moment. He was most immediately a former Eastern Orthodox deacon. Before that, he was a minister in the Way Corps. He'll talk about that in a little bit, but now he's a Catholic deacon. And before we get to Deacon Joseph, though, you are an essential part of the program. So if you have any calls, any questions you'd like to present to Deacon Joseph, you can call us at 1-800-221-9460, outside North America, 205-271-2980, or you can send us an email at journeyhome@ewtn.com. Deacon, welcome to The Journey Home.
Wonderful to be here.
It's good to have you here. I read your story when you were in our newsletter, Coming Home Network newsletter. I had a chance to, I didn't expect you'd be on the program so soon, but it's great to have you here. You've had an interesting journey, because you were often, when I have a guest on the program, we've been through similar paths, you know, either Congregationalist or Lutheran or Presbyterian. I have all that in my background, but you've got some things in your background that I didn't taste. So I'm going to get out of the way and invite you first to give us a little summary of your journey.
Sure, I'd be happy to. I think I didn't start. I have to start off to make any sense of my story. That my dad died when I was four, and when I was born, he had converted from the Protestant church. He was an Italian Protestant, and he had me baptized Catholic because he had converted to the Catholic Church. My mother, I think, really came along for the ride, you know, to follow my father. But so I was baptized in the Catholic Church. My folks weren't really big churchgoers, so I didn't really learn much. But somehow I remember getting, I had my first communion, and I was confirmed, I think it was at 11. I didn't go to Catholic schools, I went to public schools. My mother, after I was confirmed, shortly after that, she felt she had kept her obligation to my father's memory to have me get through my sacraments as a Catholic, and then she took me to the Pentecostal church with her. And within, I'd say, about, you know, a couple of months, their pastor was informing me how the church, the Catholic Church, was the whore of Babylon, and that they had lost the truth long before, when Paul, by the time Paul wrote Timothy, the Catholic Church was already there, and he was, you know, they were messing everything up. And so that's when the truth was all lost by the end of the first century, you know, when the apostles all died. And it wasn't until the Reformation that the truth came back into the world.
Were you buying it at that age?
Well, I you know.
You didn't know anything?
I was 11, 12 years old. I did buy it. I mean, I didn't have any strong teachers or role models to have shown me differently or to, you know.
The hoops of the church becoming confirmed and catechized without really a deep conviction and what
right.
you had learned. All right.
Right. Although there were, you know, a couple of people I remember from my youth, an old Salesian brother that was kind of like a father figure to me. But needless to say, when your mother says you're going to go, and if you ever had an Italian mother and said we're going to go to the Pentecostal church, and
I didn't have an Italian mother.
Well, if you did, you would know what I mean. So from there, I was involved with the Assemblies of God for a while, which is one of the Pentecostal churches. And then when I was in high school, I got just towards the end of high school, I met a group called they called themselves the Way International, which was a charismatic type of group. And they, as time went on, their doctrines changed over time. But at first, they seemed like just like any other type of evangelical Pentecostal type church. But they were essentially started to teach things like, you know, Jesus is not God, and, you know, a few things like that, which when we realized the what was going on and why it was being taught, and a lot of other doctrinal errors, and a lot of them had to do with the sexual things, with abortion. For instance, they taught that life didn't begin until the baby took his first breath, because it was the nefesh kai, the breath life, and so therefore it was no breath life. But then there were a lot of improprieties going on amongst the higher ups in this organization, and a good way to rectify their problems is to have abortions. So from there, when we came to the realization of what was really going on.
You had met your wife?
I met my wife, yeah.
Because she had been a part of that, right?
Yes. Yeah, she was a part of that. We got married 2 days after I graduated. Their leadership training program was like seminary, you know. We took the 4-year leadership training program. And they called it the Way Corps. And they wanted like spiritual Marines, you know. You want to be like the Way Corps. But we had a few assignments. We started some mission churches. And then finally we were in Nevada. And my wife and I, you know, we loved God. I mean, we really, truly believed that Jesus was our Lord and Savior. We had a personal relationship that we felt that, you know, we were sorry for our sins, that we wanted to live the truth. And we were seeking that. And it came to the point where we were, when we were deciding to leave, and we knew we had to leave there, but then where do we go from there? Where do you go? I think not too long ago, I was listening to one of the shows on EWTN, and there was a doctor, I think he's a psychologist, that's on the radio too. I forget his name. You probably know him.
And probably Ray Grundy.
Yeah. And he was saying there was like 30,000 different denominations, Protestant. And this, what it came to is, you know, in our Bible study, in our seminary, I'm sure like most Protestant seminaries, Catholic, that you'd study Greek, you study Hebrew, maybe a little Aramaic. And then when you meet and discuss doctrine, everyone will say, well, this Greek word means this and this and this. And if it means this and this and this, then this is why we believe this and this and this. But every group believes something different, and they got the same Greek words and the same Aramaic words, you know?
Just giving them different slants, different...
Yeah, but really, right. I mean, we had a couple years where we really didn't fellowship outside of our home, my wife and I. And then we finally, I was really, you know, bugging my wife a lot about this. And she said, well, why don't you talk to the Greeks then? Because they ought to know what the Greek language is all about. So I thought, well, you know, it made sense to me more than any other argument that I heard. So as I started studying, picked up some history, I talked to a few friends who that were involved with Campus Crusade for Christ. And there was a whole group around, I don't know, around the early 90s maybe, a whole group of Orthodox, they called themselves the Evangelical Orthodox Church. And they were former Campus Crusade of Christ, right. And they had gotten together over periods of time and studied the church fathers and early development of liturgy, and they realized that the way that the Orthodox and the Catholics understand scripture and the church fathers and liturgy was right, and they were wrong. And they decided to make a switch. And having read some of their books and having read all the books I could about Orthodoxy, Bishop Callistos Ware wrote a couple wonderful books on the Orthodox faith. I decided that, you know, after a while of praying, discerning, that was what I wanted to do. Well, I was on Cape Cod at the time, and the only church was it was about 20 miles away. There's the only Greek church on Cape Cod, and it was Greek, and it was very Greek in the sense of most of the Mass was all done in Greek, and the culture was almost to be a Greek Orthodox in this, and maybe in this particular place, it was you would have to embrace the Hellenistic culture along with the language and everything, and you know it was hard for us, being Americans, to fit in. So I picked up the phone and I talked to the Antiochian archdiocese, the secretary for the bishop, and I explained to him that I felt my wife and I wanted to be Orthodox, but there wasn't any Orthodox church. And his secretary told me that, well, then start a mission. And my wife said, well, we could do that because we did it with the way and the other groups that we were in. And so we did, and we started a mission, put some ads in the papers, a pan-Orthodox mission, and who's interested, call my number. He got a few phone calls, a little evangelization, and before we know it, you know, and it really was a pan. We had Russian Orthodox, we had Ukrainian Orthodox, you know, we had all Arabic, of course. And then after about a year and a half, the bishop invited me to take their leadership training program. It's called the St. Stephen's Course in Orthodox Theology, which was designed for a lot of the former ministers and other denominations who had become Orthodox. And some of them went on to be priests, some became deacons, and you know, because in the Eastern churches, they can be married, the priests can be married. So they can be ordained if they're married, but not after. Just to make that clear there. So it's the same as in the Roman church in that regard, and in the Eastern churches, within the Catholic family.
So you eventually became an Orthodox deacon?
Yes. I was ordained a subdeacon, and then about a year later, I was ordained a deacon. And then I was given the responsibility to be the administrator of the parish, because we had a priest that could only come from Boston, which is about an hour and a half from Cape Cod, where I was. And maybe every 4 to 6 weeks, you know, we could get a priest. So meanwhile, we had kind of a reader's type service, or what we call a typica service, which is kind of almost like a heavy morning prayer with a communion service combined with it.
Now, you worked on the side, right?
Yes,
I was. You had a small church, so you were supporting your family.
Yes.
Through other means.
Yes, I was a master barber from, you know, I learned that in high school, and pretty much it kept me going all my life. And my wife and I, we built a house on Cape Cod, and I had my own barber business after a while. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now, you were drawn to the Orthodox Church primarily because the clarification of the Greek was kind of the main.
Well, because I was I wanted to find one voice that said that I could trust somehow, that this, I would know that when I read the Greek or the Hebrew, who's to tell me that what I'm believing is right? I realized that it wasn't, if everyone could interpret it according to their own, or as what we were taught that the Bible interprets itself, that it's of no man's private interpretation, but if it is, then how come there's so many different denominations? Yeah. If it's just the Holy Spirit is going to teach us all, who's to say who's right and wrong?
Yeah, I wish I had the right, correct wording, but there was a famous confession called the Westminster Confession, which was dear to my heart when I was a Presbyterian, Congregationalist and Presbyterian. And it was interesting that one of the lines in that, again, I wish for the audience's sake I'd get it right, maybe check the internet and make sure the wording's right, but when it talked about the authority of Scripture, it talked about the authority of Scripture rested in the original writings. And there's truth to that, but the negative to that is that what that does, it makes it only those that can read the original writings can be certain that they're not being misled by a middleman, a committee or a translator that has maybe shifted the translation with a particular ideology. And what that did, that kind of raised up to the top of authority those who could read Greek, those that could read Hebrew. And so if you could at least claim to interpret Greek, then you had it one up over anyone that couldn't. And essentially what you're saying is, with all these voices out there, let's go to the Greek. Let's go to the Greeks, they ought to know. Now, also, you had a Catholic baptism and a Catholic, you were brought into the church, catechism, confirmed. At that time, did you have any leanings at all to the Catholic Church when you were thinking of Orthodoxy, or had that Pentecostal influence poisoned you?
The Pentecostal influence really pushed me, but there also is a kind of a underlying negative feeling from the Orthodox towards Catholics, especially the Slavic Catholics, maybe more than some of the others, like the Russian Orthodox or so on.
Towards the Catholics,
towards the
of
Roman,
their
yeah.
own ethnic background. The Russian Orthodox would have a chip on a shoulder against the Russian Catholics.
No, against any Catholic.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
Okay. I wonder if you meant those.
No, no, not just particularly.
Ethnic. Okay, I didn't want to. All right, well then there you
that
are.
That was my perception.
Right, okay, in the place where you were living. All right, so you're an Orthodox deacon, supporting yourself as a barber. Okay, growing church, people showing interest. Well, then what got your mind interested in the Catholic Church?
A good question. My wife used to ask me that for a while until she started to understand. Why? I contracted Lyme disease, which is you get a little bite from a tick the size of a pin, the head of a pin, which you can't see, and it can wreak a lot of havoc in your body, in your pain and everything. And I had a really bad case of it, and I still suffered residual effects of that. But when I first became ill with Lyme disease, I was home and I was on IVs in my home. Not much I could do, but so what I did is I took the time to pray and I took the time to study. I got into all those volumes of the Ante-Nicene Fathers and, then I see if I had the whole set of them, being a good Orthodox deacon, I had to have the set of them.
All the early church fathers.
Yeah, and I think I was coming across, reading John Chrysostom, and one thing that, I know other people have those experiences where you feel like all of a sudden you read something you saw before, but this time it's like somebody hit you in the head with a hammer and you wrestle with it because you can't stop thinking about it. And it was just a little thing he said was that schism was worse than heresy because it divided the body of Christ. Hmm. And so if schism was worse than heresy, then why was there this great division between the Roman Church and the Orthodox? Basically, they have the same history. I mean, for the first 1,000 years, everything is now a little bit maybe a different understanding as far as the part of the world they came from and the way that the Semitic people might look at the scriptures in a little bit of different angle, but the same truth, the same truth. And during this time also, it was around Holy Week in the Western calendar. And I turned the TV on, and it was our Holy Father, John Paul II, and he died. He was doing the Stations of the Cross outside around the Colosseum. And during his carrying the cross, he stopped and diverted from his text, his prepared text. He took a deep breath, and he looked right in the camera, and I thought he was looking right at me. I still, to this day, I feel that. And he said, the church must breathe with two lungs, the east and the west. And he all of a sudden that really hit me. And I'm like, yeah, he's right. Why are we separated? And the more I looked into it, the more I studied, the more I was convinced I think there was some, pride on both ends of the spectrum that caused the schism to happen. But I also got in, especially one book I read, it was Jesus, Peter, and the Keys. And Marcus, you had the one of the authors on your, I don't know if all of them, but one of them,
David Hess.
Yeah, David Hess was on your show. Mm-hmm. And I read that book, and he goes right through the scripture, and he explains from the scripture why Peter has the keys, and only Peter is the keys. And he goes into the Davidic kingdom and the Queen Mother, and he goes into so much, you'd have to read the book, but right. If someone's interested in knowing more about it, I would recommend that book.
Yeah, Jesus, Peter, and the Keys. Three authors, Scott Butler and David Hess. I forget the third, I apologize for that. Mm-hmm. It's Queenship is the publisher. It's a fine book, it's a fine collection of the proof texts, if you want to say it that way,
right.
But the early references to the early fathers, particularly as well as scripture, of the authority that the Bishop of Rome held in the early days of the church. So how do you, were you finding it appealing all along? Or were you beating against the goads as you were reading that?
Well, after, like I said, I was reading the book. It was after I read the John Chrysostom's words. And so I think I was more open to it now. And I started to see that a lot of things that I thought was what the Pentecostal Church had told me was wrong with the Catholic Church were well embraced by the Orthodox. And so, in the Orthodox claim, I was ordained by a bishop who was ordained by someone who was ordained by someone from Peter and Paul in Antioch. So, they were first called Christians in Antioch, right? So they had the same beliefs, the same structure, Ignatius of Antioch, where the bishop is, there is the church, there is Christ. You had the same ideas. I think that it wasn't the things you would find in books that was discouraging me, but more some of the examples of Catholics that maybe didn't show that they believed in those things that that they do, they're supposed to believe in, that's in the books.
Yeah. So on the one hand, you were finding that the Orthodox Church believed many of the same things that the Catholic Church believed that the Pentecostals would put down, like sacraments and apostolic succession and the hierarchy. But there would also be things that Pentecostals would say about the Catholic Church that aren't true. Did you deal with those too? Because you would find those were also not true about the Orthodox
right,
either.
Right.
I mean, were you faced with those issues?
I realized it as I was studying Orthodox, and I said, wait a minute. This is what they were saying, that the church, the Catholic Church was bad, but the Orthodox, they showed in their books, I mean, you can go back and you can see that they worship basically the same way from the earliest writings of anybody writing about liturgies and so on. Well, I wasn't taught that about the Catholic Church.
So to what point did then you find yourself leaning to the Catholic Church itself, and did you make a... Was it a quick journey in, or?
Well, in my heart it was. Yeah. It took time, because of my family and so on. But when I finally made up my mind, and my wife was on board with me, you know, which was important to me. It was very important to me. Not that I wouldn't have sought to be reunited with the fullness of the faith, but I wanted to, if it was possible to do it with her, I felt that was important. But when I finally made up my mind, then my wife and I, we wrote a letter to our bishop and explained to him, just like some of the things I share with you about my illness and having time to contemplate and so on. But he wasn't too happy with the letter or with my decision.
Well, many would say that if the Orthodox and the Catholic Church are so similar, why make the jump?
All right, that's a good question too. Because
what were the issues that
really with me was the issue of there is in Orthodoxy you have a lot of self-ruling churches, but they're all say that they're Orthodox and they believe the same things. But if there's a dispute among them, they used to have in history an emperor who could lay the law down and get the bishops together and the hierarchs and say, you're going to do this and that's it, straighten it out, get a council together. They don't have that anymore. And so now, I mean, you could have the patriarch of Russia being upset over a jurisdiction matter of who in the Balkans is going to be, they want to be under the ecumenical patriarch of Constantinople, or do they want to be under the Russian, and the Russian want to keep them under them, but now the communist borders broke up, the Soviet Union, and there were disputes, and well, I'm not talking to him, he's not talking to me, and now there's no communion between them. You know, there's no one to go to because they don't go to Peter anymore, you see.
They haven't had a council since the division.
Right, they had seven great councils, and that was it.
Did, when you were an Orthodox, did they consider themselves unified?
Yeah, because they said they were unified, but they all believed the same thing.
All right. But what about issues?
Now, there were issues that were coming up with, for instance, birth control. Some of the bishops, I would, if you talked to them, or priests, they would say, absolutely, he's immoral. You know, but most of them I talked to, and at the, you know, talking to people at the seminary, the Greek seminary in Boston area, Roxbury, West Roxbury, they would say that this is an individual matter between the two married couples. So, you know, between the husband and wife and the church, you know, there's nothing in the councils about that.
Right.
So, you know, we're not saying whatever they want, you know, it's between them and God.
So to a certain extent, any of the major issues that arise, they can't have a unified voice.
Well, I would think it'd be hard, you know, unless it's an issue that was already handled by the councils. When we come to some of the newer ones, like what are they doing with genetics? Unless they all get together and they can speak with one voice. And then there's another one, a problem of, I believe that, say, in the Catholic Church, you felt your ministry, say you were a priest or a deacon, and you felt that you weren't being treated fairly in a given situation, I believe you could go to the Holy See and you could explain you had the court of last appeal. You could go somewhere and get a problem settled. In Orthodoxy, you're just with your bishop.
How did your bishop and Court of Appeal respond to your desire to go to the Catholic Church?
I'd just say the letter wasn't a very edifying letter. It was a pretty negative letter, and he told me I was reduced to the rank of layman, and he didn't really have a priest talk to me or anything at that point, and it was just a matter of, you're laicized now. And
well, talk about coming into the church. You've come in, and now you've got a cross around your neck. So talk about your own journey.
Well, when I got sick, and I at the same time, because of my illness, I wasn't able to go back to work, and I became disabled. So the house, the nice house on the Cape Cod that I built, and I ended up losing the house, and I couldn't keep working in my barber business, so I lost that. And then I lost the little income that I had from being the administrator of the mission. And so we didn't know what we were gonna do, I was on the internet at a Catholic chat room, and telling people, I was excited about coming back to the church, and I met someone from Buffalo, New York, and I explained to this woman and her husband my situation. And she said, well, I have a friend who's a Ukrainian Catholic priest, and I'm going to tell him about this. And this priest drove from Buffalo about three times within a year and came and met with us. And he's by ritual priest. He's, he has Roman faculties too. And he drove out there. He drove out there about three times. And he met with us. He pastored us. And he even got a bunch of people together to donate money to move us out to Buffalo and helped us find a place to live. And then once I was in Buffalo, Bishop Mansell is Archbishop Mansell in Hartford. He met with me personally upon the recommendation of one of the priests, friends of his. And he set up my own little curriculum, how he wanted me to, what courses he wanted me to take, a few courses to add to my training that I had in two other churches, and then I had a right to the Holy See, and if Cardinal Ratzinger wrote me back, wrote the diocese, the bishop, informing him that these impediments or irregularities canonically were removed, and it was up to the bishop's pleasure to receive me and give me faculties and cardinate me in his diocese. So it was on the Feast of St. Dominic, August 8th, 2005, where I finally was incarnated into Buffalo.
Serving as a deacon.
Yeah.
Well, excellent. Let's take a break, and we'll come back just a moment with your questions for Deacon Joseph. See you in a bit. Welcome back to The Journey Home. Our guest tonight is Deacon Joseph Pasquella. And thank you, Joseph, for sharing, condensing your journey. I mean, it's always hard to do that. Before we get in, we've got a few emails. Before I get there, I'd like to, is the way still active? Because I'm not sure the audience has been familiar with the presence of the way.
The way, shortly after the founder of the way, Dr. Victor Paul Werwell, he passed away. And then there was a big schism, and there is a Way International still in New Knoxville, Ohio. The leadership have all changed, and other big chunks of the group broke off, and they started other ministries, and from some of the top leadership that They just, it's all split up. It's not anything like it used to be.
All right. Is it any more? Is it closer to evangelical Protestantism, or is it?
No, it's still, in other words, it's still rejecting the deity of Christ. And the Holy Spirit is considered as the energy of God, but not a person.
So it's pretty New Age.
It's either, well, actually, they believe in the scriptures when it talks about the Spirit of God, that it means God the Father and the Holy Spirit are one. It's just because God is spirit.
Okay.
You see?
All right. So they reject the Trinity.
Yeah,
a great variety of things. Which, of course, that's the danger. Once you've rejected Peter, then it's like knocking the top off a volcano, and you got the mess. And so you've got all the different ideas that will erupt.
Particular group, they also reject all councils. They believe that the only the scriptures themselves are inspired, and that no traditions are only traditions of men and not the traditions of God.
All right. You wonder where they got the scriptures from, where they think about where the scriptures came from, but I doubt if that ever comes up.
Some think that the King James Bible is the Word of God, period.
Yeah. All right. Okay. So there's a real conservative, interesting, kind of a mixed of a real fundamentalist conservative King James, yet the freedom of interpretation that leads to a lot of strange ideas. All right. I've got an email here. This comes from Adam. Dear Deacon Joseph, I find your story very interesting. Before I converted to the Catholic Church, I was Anglican. I did not want to be Catholic. I fought it tooth and nail. Does that sound familiar at all? I visited an Orthodox parish for some time and almost joined. I just could not justify the Protestant or Orthodox explanations for rejecting the Pope. Did this have an effect on you?
Well, yeah. Earlier in the program, I mentioned that I had a struggle with that also, but having read Jesus, Peter, and the Keys, for me, was a very scriptural book itself. I mean, really, it touched on the early councils, but on the scriptures themselves and the whole idea of what it meant in the David's kingdom to have the keys and what that meant in a legalistic way in the Jewish kingdom. And so, yes, once you take it upon that, and then what did Jesus tell Peter? You are Peter, the rock, Petra, the rock in the Greek, and on this Petra I will build my church. And the gates of hell will not, how's it go?
I can't remember the rest of it. Right.
Yeah, yeah. I lost my mind there for a minute. Well, my wife says I always lose my mind. So.
it's always hard just to recommend a book to someone, Jesus, Peter, and the Keys, because I know there's so many arguments
right.
in there. You mentioned, the truth that's in Matthew 16 and that whole issue of the rock and the keys. Anything else from that book that, I know it's a lot of early church fathers. Any of the arguments from the book that you can remember that you'd like to point out to the audience? Because there's so many.
Well, yeah, like I said, mostly he takes time. I got to say, the biggest argument is from a scriptural standpoint. If people who are very geared to say, well, if where's that in the Bible?
Yeah.
I think that this answers the question. And again, from an Orthodox point of view, and I think one of the deacons who wrote the book, David, is a Byzantine Catholic deacon.
Yes, that's right. That's right. He's been on the program. Okay, let's take another email. This comes from Alan in Alabama. Dear Deacon Joseph, in your journey, did you ever think of joining an Eastern Catholic Church? Thanks and God bless, Alan.
Yeah, I did. However, because I was baptized in the Roman Rite, in the Roman Church, therefore, it was the best way to go back in is the way you left, Yeah. As one of the bishops I had talked with, and he said, well, it's not impossible, but it would be better if you just came in through the same rite that you were. It's almost like when you're baptized a certain rite, that's your rite that you belong with,
Yeah. But you also have a strong affinity and affection for the Eastern liturgy.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Very much so.
All right. We've got another email. This comes from Robert in California. Dear Marcus and Deacon, does the Eastern Orthodox Church have the same devotion to our Blessed Mother as the Catholic Church? Thank you, Robert.
They don't have the rosary, but they have, like, we call the Akathist hymns, certain hymns and devotions in that regard that are very much identical to the same idea, where they refer to as Theotokos, the God, the one who carries God, in her womb. So this, literally, the God carrier in her womb. So yeah, she's Mother of God, and they believe in every liturgy There are prayers during the Mass. There are prayers for the intercessions of the Theotokos to intercede for the church.
I know another thing that's different, uniquely different. The Jesus prayer is big in the Eastern Church,
right?
Wasn't it? I mean, was that a part of your experience?
Yeah, in fact, that's why I wear my prayer robe tonight here. It's a custom in Eastern Catholics and Orthodox often wear a prayer robe, and they're little knots, and each knot consists of three knots. So it's Trinitarian. Mm-hmm. And there was a story that a monk was learning to say his Jesus prayer, but he would make these knots to count them. But at night, the devil would come and untie him. So he asked what to do, and the legend is that the angel came and showed him how to make the three knots that would make one knot, and that the devil couldn't untie it anymore. So that's the story.
So like the Western Church that went with the Rosary, the Eastern Church has a similar devotion, but with the Jesus.
Yeah, and they often call it the Eastern Rosary, you know. They call it their Rosary, some groups.
I'm sure there's some in the audience that when they've heard people talk about the Jesus Prayer but do not know what the Jesus Prayer is.
Well, you know, the short answer is that the Jesus Prayer is a prayer that you would say on each one of these knots or without. Right. And you would say, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. The idea of the prayer is the whole idea of theosis, which is we were saved when we were baptized. We are being saved, and ultimately we're going to be saved. So it's not a one-time thing. And this is a process of divination that we are becoming like God. Little by little, if we're faithful, we receive the sacraments, that we're going to be God's. You know,
well, not
in
like
a sense.
Not like the Mormons think.
No,
that sense. But we experience the eternal life, which is an experience
in the divine
life.
When I serve as a deacon in the Western Church, the deacon drops during Mass, he puts a drop of water in the chalice, and through the mingling of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. It's the same idea. Yeah. So it's Catholic, it's Orthodox, you see.
All right. It's a wonderful prayer, and I encourage you, if you haven't prayed the Jesus Prayer, it's a wonderful devotional prayer of surrender to Christ, Lord Jesus Christ. Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. You know, it's a wonderful prayer. Great tradition. And it is not just Eastern. It has a great tradition in the Western Church, though it's not quite as popular because the Rosary has won so much affection in our history. Let's have another email. This comes from John Paul in Pennsylvania. Dear Deacon Joseph, how do you think we can foster unity between Orthodox and Catholic Christians?
Well, the Eastern Catholic churches have the same customs and the same theology, basically, you know, except where they accept the Holy Father and the Vatican II and, you know, councils like that after the seven great ones, how it applies to them and their churches. They have their own canon laws and so on, but they have retained the customs of the East, and where they had it developed some what they called Westernizations or Latinizations. The John Paul II, the great, our Pope, who passed away, God bless his memory, he encouraged them, go back to your original, you know, your original ideas, your original ways of doing things, your methods.
All right. We've got another email here, comes from James from Florida, Marcus and Deacon Joseph. Explain the Eastern Orthodox Church's understanding of the Bishop of Rome as being first among equals. Thank you, James.
Well, the Eastern Church believes, or this is what they would teach you in the Orthodox Church, is that they believe that the Holy Father, the Pope, has a place of respectful leadership, but like a titular position without any teeth. Doesn't have universal jurisdiction. Although they will admit that in the times in the past, they often have gone to him to settle disputes among churches, among jurisdictions and so on, but they would claim that this was just like going to your older brother and asking his opinion. Not really that the church had such a power, or that the Pope had such a universal jurisdiction as they would term. So first among equals, like the patriarch in Constantinople is known as the ecumenical patriarch, and so he takes that title, which really belongs to the Pope.
But that's a bit of reading back into history.
Yes.
because in fact, when you look at the early councils, they were always expecting to have either yea or nay from the Bishop of Rome
right.
to affirm whether that was true or not. So there was definitely an issue. And the other thing that I found when I was going through the same struggle myself on my journey to the Catholic Church, examining Orthodoxy versus the Catholic Church, is that what most impressed me was that great Eastern Orthodox saints recognized the authority of the Bishop of Rome. I mean, Chrysostom, who we see great quotes from these early fathers, as well as, and this is something that takes a little research for those of you who are out there, if you got the question, you can find some books probably in seminary books, libraries, probably the only place you can find them. But looking at the words of the prayers of the earliest liturgies of the Eastern Church, when a part of the liturgy, there's always great prayers when they're praying for the bishops. And whenever they would pray for the Bishop of Rome, it was always different than the rest. It always showed a great affection and a recognition of the authority of the Bishop of Rome. And those are in the Eastern churches in their liturgy. So I've always found that a great witness for the early recognition of the authority. And of course, you got to remember that one of the reasons that you didn't see as many references to the authority of the bishop in Rome during the first couple centuries is because there's some problems going on. I mean, there's persecution.
Persecution.
And so the church was very much under under the control, under persecution, under wraps, often pushed away as people were trying to survive the faith. And so it wasn't until later that you see the flowering of what had really been there all along in maybe a less developed way, but developed
later. Then you have that first heresy, the big heresy, Arius, a priest in the East who said that Jesus wasn't God, just like the way is doing, you know?
That's right. Right, just old heresies being rehashed. Let's take this email from Patricia in Cincinnati, Ohio. Hi, Marcus. My family and I look forward to watching your show every Monday night. The Roman Catholics and the Orthodox Catholics have such beautiful icons, but many Protestants, such as your former denomination, Pentecostals, condemn icons. How would you explain the use of icons as theologically appropriate? Thank you, Patricia.
Well, I would look at it this way, because before Jesus was born and took on humanity, there was a prohibition of idolatry. You could not make any image of God. But the fathers of the church argued that because one of the key things is because of the incarnation of God, that God's picture could be depicted. And so because God's picture could be depicted, Jesus, so also the saints, and so on. Now, we as Catholics don't, and Orthodox either, do not worship the icons. It is like if you see someone kissing an icon or a statue, they're giving that to the person it represents. Yeah. But in the Eastern Church, especially, the icons are considered windows to heaven because they believe it's the Word of God in pictures and colors. And they actually don't refer to it as paintings. They say this icon was written. And the process of writing an icon, I mean, most of the time it was monks who did it, and they would go for a blessing from the bishop, and then the bishop would give them a blessing, and they would fast and pray all through the time that they were writing the icon.
I mean, there was controversy about it at times, but often it was because they misunderstood. And interestingly enough, if a person has a problem praying to an icon, if they don't themselves have a good clarity on what's happening, if they're too distracted by it, then they assume everybody's distracted by it and let me get rid of it,
right.
As opposed to being correctly catechized to understand that we're focusing not so much on the picture, but who it's represent through it. I mean, that's the beauty of beautiful
I've seen, for instance, Protestants, Pentecostals, Baptists, they might have a picture of their dear old mother who passed away, and they might sit there at night and look at that picture and kiss the picture. Are they worshiping the picture? Are they worshiping their mother? No. You know, it's the same.
Yeah, very much so. Bring them back into their memory, bring them back the emotions and the beauty of what that picture represents. Okay, let's see if we have another email here. I have one ready for us. Comes from Harold. Dear Marcus and Deacon, what are effective ways to talk to Orthodox about Catholicism, Eastern Catholic churches? God bless. Yeah, any effective ways. It's not always easy. But
No, it's not, because if you take someone who's catechized well, informed well in the Catholic faith, they know their faith well, and so would the Orthodox if he was or she was formed in her faith. Where we both, I think where you can, is the church fathers. We have the same church fathers and doctors of the church, so we can go there. And then from there, we can work up and say, well, really, what was this schism about? Ask yourself that question and what led to it. And how we, you know, today, we just have to undo that. And it takes humility and prayer on both ends. And they are our sister churches. They are not heretics, the Orthodox.
Sometimes I've found when you're dealing with, and my work is more with evangelical Protestants, that I've found that often it's more effective to help them recognize maybe there's problems in Protestantism and then let the Spirit lead them to the truth of the Catholic faith. Yeah. You know, help them see the fallacy of sola scriptura or sola fide or some of those important pillars of the Reformation. With Eastern Orthodox, how do they face up to the reality of disunity within their ranks? I mean, is that a way?
But again, it's a more of an illusion, because they feel that they will tell you, we have unity because we all believe the same thing. We all have the same faith. And that's the standard answer if you ask them that. They say that our church has always had autonomy between one church and another.
So would they say they're united with the Catholics? Because other than belief in papal authority, we pretty much believe almost all the same thing.
Well, no, see, they would say that they never accepted purgatory.
Okay.
That it's not one of the... But yeah, if you go to the Slavic the Slavic Orthodox, they have what they call toll houses, and it's kind of like a, you know, it's a long thing, but it's like a purgatory.
You pay your toll as you're going up?
Yeah, it's a long drawn out. They call it spiritual toll houses, one of the saints.
So it just,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah. But or now they do not believe in the Immaculate Conception, the Orthodox churches. But they believe that
there are some that do, though.
No, they believe that when the angel Gabriel came to Mary and said, "Hail Mary, full of grace," at that moment she was cleansed of all sin, you know, the sin of Adam, and then now she was perfectly clean. And at that moment, but before that, she wasn't born without sin. Like the Catholic
liturgy. There's an example of where it's a timing issue.
Yes.
In terms of Orthodox and Catholics. We believe the same thing about Mary, but it's just when it happened, it's a bit different. All right. Okay.
The bread, they will argue that the bread should be leavened bread. And they say that the Passover, really, Jesus didn't spend the Passover with the disciples. It was after the Passover that he ate the supper, you know. It was, okay. So
there are, what they're saying is there's enough differences that they would say there is not the unity, because there's a lot of things that we don't believe the same. Is that what?
Yeah, but I think that the biggest thing is the papal authority. Right. I think they could, with enough scholars, they could get over to other ones, you know?
Okay. Let's take one more email, then we'll take a break. This comes from Thomas. Dear Deacon, explain the theology behind the Eastern Church facing east during the prayers, especially during the Holy Sacrifice in the Divine Liturgy. Thanks, Thomas.
Well, facing east, I believe, was a custom in all Christian churches. I know in the Roman Rite, the priests used to face east in the Trinitine Mass. I don't think it's ever been forbidden. I mean, we have, I guess, what you'd call a floating altar, so to speak. You can walk all around it. But if the priest wanted to face east, I don't know if there's any, other than his being obedient to his bishop, if his bishop said, no, we don't want that.
But the tradition, the tradition itself goes way back.
Yeah, I don't know when it wasn't. I think it goes back to the Judaism, perhaps, you know, from the time of when we came out of, the church came out of Judaism.
Yeah, from Old Testament prophecy about the sun rising.
And also Christ is supposed to return in the east and so on.
All right. Why don't we take a break, and we'll come back in a moment with some more questions for you. See you in a bit. Welcome back to The Journey Home. Our guest tonight is Deacon Joseph, and thank you very much for answering the questions about, sometimes a little tricky with answering the questions about Orthodoxy and Catholicism. Very similar, and they're our beloved brothers and sisters. We pray for unity. I mean, yes. That's what John Paul was praying for when he said we need to breathe from both lungs. And he was really reaching out and asking for that. But, I mean, sometimes they've got a long memory, right?
Yes.
Sometimes that gets in the way, inability to let go. And so we need to pray for that and pray that it, that we do see the work of the Holy Spirit and bringing that, the breaking of that schism and bringing them home. Let's say that we've got a few watching out there, maybe an Orthodox watching, or maybe someone from the way is actually watching, I don't know. What would you like to say to them to encourage them to consider making the same journey home you've made?
Well, I would have to say that, you know, we have to continue to seek God no matter where we are in our walk. And if we are honest and continue to seek Him, I believe that God will lead us all to the same truth.
And it's the danger of just the scriptures alone as the only authority is that you can come up with, as you mentioned earlier, a lot of conclusions, all of which can be a bit contradictory.
Exactly.
But recognizing that Christ gave us an authority in the church, as well as founded on Peter, to help us discern whether the opinion we've come up with is close to the truth or not.
Yeah, I think Saint Paul into the Romans explained how are people going to know anything if we don't teach them? And how are we going to be taught if no one goes out to teach?
Yeah.
Unless someone goes out to teach them, you know, it takes someone to really teach them. Like, yeah. I'm reminded of Philip, the deacon who was talking to the queen's, was it Queen Ethiopia's eunuch?
Yeah.
You know, he's reading Isaiah and he goes, I don't have any idea what this means. He's praying, poof, God sends a deacon over there to preach to him. And, what are you reading Isaiah? But I don't know what it means. Well, I can tell you what it means. And by the way, he baptizes him.
Well, that represents the authority of the church to help them yes. understand, to bring out the meaning of that. How about a final, as a deacon, how about a blessing for us tonight?
Sure.
Deacon
Joseph. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love and your mercy in our lives and for blessing us always. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
All right. Deacon Joseph, thank you very much for joining us. And we do ask God's blessing on your ministry as a deacon. It's a very important work. Helping us know how we are to follow Christ as we imitate you, right? That's what we're called to do. Laymen imitate the deacons and the priests as they show us how to follow Christ. So thank you very much. Thank you for joining us on The Journey Home. I hope this has been an encouragement to you. One of the things we deal with on a program tonight as Deacon Joseph dealt with his own journey is that we recognize the need for the church that Christ gave us in his apostles. So we make sure that we're not leaning on our own understanding, but that we're listening the truth as Christ gave it to us in the scriptures, guided by the church. God bless you. See you again next week.